Hi everyone, Fiona Doyle back again. And today I decided to talk to you about something that's kind of special and a little sad. Myself and my husband Jim will be 11 years married. So this is myself and Jim here. This is why I'm sitting here beside the photograph. Myself and Jim, in a sense, ran away to get married. And Jim did that for me because I was having such an issue with having family at my wedding. I made the awful decision when I got married for the first time back in the 1990s, of letting my father walk me down the aisle. And he walked me down the aisle. Christmas, it was snowing, and he wasn't speaking to me because the week before I had a row with my mother, and I had said about my father raping and abusing me, and I still let them come to my wedding, and we had a church wedding, and we were asked to show each other the sign of peace during the ceremony. And I turned around to shake my mother's hand, and she refused. So, not only has my first wedding got a lot of bad memories, but then we come to my second wedding and the amazing Jim. Jim proposed to me after 6 weeks, and we planned on having, well, we initially started to plan on having a proper wedding, but I then told him about my past, and I told him about my fears and about my family involvement in the wedding and how I regretted that I let my father walk me down the aisle before. And every time after I got engaged that I saw my mother, I would have sarcastic remarks or, "What are you doing now? Why isn't so and so going to be your bridesmaid?" And there was just awful bitchiness and hardness going on. So we decided that we were going to go away and get married. And it was December we were going away, and it was such short notice from my children that they couldn't come to our wedding. So myself and Jim went off on our own, and we got married in Barbados. We had made friends with a couple over there, and we asked them to be a witness in our marriage. And I remember the morning we were due to get married, I was due to go off and have my makeup done and my hair done. And I was sitting in the bed and I was telling Jim how sad I was. And then, of course, my daughter rings me and to wish me luck on the day. And it hit me so badly that my children weren't there. I cried down the phone to Crystal, and then I had a really good cry when I got off the phone to Jim, telling him that I regretted not waiting to have my children around me. I wanted my boys to walk me down the aisle, and I wanted Crystal to walk behind me as my maid of honor. So, of course, none of that happened. And I realized after a while the sacrifice that Jim had made for me, really, because it was his first time getting married. So he didn't have the big wedding, the best man, his family there. He really had nothing. And he did that for me because he loved me. Now, it was romantic as well. We got married in a very old sugar mill. We had a, it wasn't a church wedding, it was like a registry wedding. And we then went across on the beach and took some fabulous photographs. And we had a photographer there kind of photographing us, signing the register and things like that. And Jim played, Patrick had bought me a CD for my wedding song, and I wanted to play The Rose as I was walking towards Jim. And Patrick had bought me this CD of, I think it was Westlife, of them singing The Rose. And then when we got married and we were due to sign the register, Jim secretly organised for that song, You Are Beautiful to Me. And he had that played for me. So we had a good day, really. It was a romantic day. But in the background, I was still sad inside. And the main sadness was my children weren't there. We ended up going to, we had a wedding dinner on the beach. And our wedding dinner was lobster. And I sat down and I said to Jim, I had a taste of the lobster, and I said to him, duck. I said, what? I said, duck. He put his head down and I threw the lobster over his head into the sand. And he says, I don't believe you did that. And he jumped up real quick to kick sand on the lobster. So the staff wouldn't know I didn't eat my own wedding dinner. But it was something that we can laugh about. We spent 10 days in Barbados, and we came back to our first Christmas together. And while we were away, we had a long talk about our future and what we wanted for the future. We knew I was pregnant, and we knew we were having a boy. So I discussed with Jim my fears about my family and living in the same area as my family. So Jim then said to me, well, let's move, let's go. And it was so easy making these decisions with somebody beside me and somebody who was going to help me and carry me. So we got through the Christmas, and in the meantime, we were house hunting. We decided we were going to go and rent a house and see how we got on living away from my family and some of my children. My older boys had jobs in Bray, and they made it quite clear that they weren't going to come with me. And then Crystal had her own house. Well, shockingly, my two boys had decided they were going to move in and live with my mother and father. And I cried and I kept saying, I don't want you to do that. Please don't do that. But of course, for me, I had made everything seem so normal to my boys that it confused them. You know, make your mind up. One minute you hate them, and then you love them, and then you hate them, and now you want us, that we had us where we loved them, and now you want us to hate them. So I had to back off again, bury my feelings about my boys moving in, my parents, and let them do it. And that's what I did. We packed up the week after Christmas, and myself, Jim, and Asun moved to Wexford. And I didn't realise at the time, but I was moving into the garden of actually sex abuse, because we had the Ferns report and everything coming out about the abuse in the church. And I didn't know or ever believe that I'd have been welcomed so much as I had done in Wexford. It's been amazing, and it was the place that helped me get through a lot. I was living in Wexford when I decided I was going to go back and go after my father again. We had our little haven down here. We walked on the beach and we walked the dogs, and we really had a good life. But things were just still a bit sad, really. After I went to the police, I remember I was in court just before Christmas, and my father had pleaded guilty, so he was getting sentenced in January. So I was told to do my victim impact statement. And I was struggling. How do I do this? Where do I start? And lo and behold, in the middle of everything, I forgot our anniversary. the 11th of December is when my, or 10th of December, sorry, God, he killed me, is when myself and Jim got married. I was sitting at home and I had decided that I needed to start the victim impact statement before Christmas because I wanted to enjoy, I'll try and enjoy my Christmas. So I was sitting at home and I was trying to write, but I just didn't know where to start. And lo and behold, in walks Jim with a bunch of flowers and a CD. And it was Tommy Fleming. And I put the CD on and the first song came on and it was called Begin. And it was all about stop looking over your shoulder and begin to live your life. And I listened to the words and I thought, how amazing was that that Jim went out and got that for me? And now those words are they mean so much to me. Stop looking over your shoulder. Stop looking for the monsters that were in your life and look forward. So I couldn't help but, you know, I hugged Jim and I kissed him and I thanked him and I said I felt so bad that I had forgotten it was our anniversary. So I think every anniversary is still that little cloud hanging over it. But my plan, when we were 11 years married, and I remember when we were away, I said to Jim, will you bring me back here when we're 10 years married? And he said, yes, I will. But of course, we didn't do that. But I will one day. I have two more cases pending. There are civil cases against the state and the guards. And my plan is when I am through those two cases, I'm through all my criminal cases, I will remarry Jim and I will give him the wedding that he missed out on. And I won't miss the family that aren't there. It's all about the family that is there. And it's all about moving forward and redoing what made me sad and redoing what I wanted to do and forget about what I did do and some of the crazy actions I did about the family and everything else. So yes, I won't ramble on any further. I am going to go because I want to do a nice dinner for my husband for the anniversary. So again, if there's anything you want to ask me, I would like you to look at the subscribe button and click that. And maybe even give me a little like, that'll be nice. But I will just remind you again that we have the Samaritans and the rape crisis. And the Dublin rape crisis number is 1-800-88-7777. So if you're having any problems, and you're coming up to the Christmas and you don't know who to what to do or who to turn to, you can ring that number, you can ring the Samaritans, or you can just message me and keep me company for a while. So I'll talk to you soon. Bye bye.